Why am I saying, but I love ginger?
I don't know, because I like the professor and Marianne, to be honest with you. Find out today on Medical History and Mystery.
Everyone, welcome to Medical History Mysteries. I'm Pam Maragliano-Muniz. With me, as always, Tom Viola.
How's everybody doing today? I hope you're all well.
I mean, I was well until I hear there's another thing I have to worry about. Always something to worry about. So I don't know about you guys, but I love ginger. I love putting ginger in water. I love to put it in tea. I like it on my sushi. And now you're telling me that there's are some precautions we need to take with ginger. What's that about?
Absolutely. So keep in mind, and welcome to spring and summer in the Northern Hemisphere. Okay. So you know what this means. People are going to be outdoors more. They're going to be more active. They're going to be doing more travel. And so there's a lot of misinformation online about dietary supplements, herbal dietary supplements like ginger, because these supplements are not regulated and not standardized by the FDA. I mean, to some extent, the FDA has some control over what claims a manufacturer can make about a dietary supplement, but not all of them are considered, you know, violation enough that the FDA would need to be involved. So you can never make a claim that a dietary supplement will treat or cure a disease, but you can say that a dietary supplement helps promote health. Okay, so let's take an example, okay? You're going to be traveling, right? Because it's that time of year. And there's a lot of information that says ginger is very effective in treating motion sickness. So if you're going to be flying and if you're taking a cruise, whatever, you might take a ginger supplement. Well, turns out it may not be that effective at all. As a matter of fact, again, it's hard to say because studies are lacking on this. But you know, if you're going to use ginger, realize that you might be better off with vitamin B6, to be honest. Okay, so that's the first thing. I'm going to use ginger. Why? Because it's the time of year. I want to be outside more. The days are longer and I got to have more endurance and, you know, and more stamina. And so ginger is often promoted to boost your endurance and boost stamina. And that may very well be true, but it may very well also be just placebo. Okay. And finally, well, you know, I'm going to be out more, eating more stuff and, you know, going to more cookouts and things that are going to upset my stomach. So I've been told that ginger, like ginger ale, will, you know, settle my stomach if I eat something that doesn't agree with me. And generally speaking, ginger itself is well tolerated, but it's really too soon. It's always been too soon and too lacking in evidence to suggest that ginger actually is helpful for treating nausea and vomiting. And finally, you know, a lot of people use ginger as aromatherapy, right? They like to, you know, make sure that their office smells like ginger. And that may be fine, but at the same time, there's no evidence to suggest that, you know, having a place smell like ginger is adding any benefit to your health whatsoever.
There's no ginger in ginger ale.
I'm glad you said that because many people believe that's true and it's just flavoring. Now, if you're wondering why I'm making such a big deal about ginger, realize that the thing we need to worry about is while ginger doesn't have any really known major drug interactions, ginger does have antiplatelet and hypoglycemic effects. So some people have compared the potential bleeding that patients experience when they take ginger to the bleeding that patients experience when they take an antiplatelet drug like Plavix. I don't know if it's that significant or that severe, but ginger, we know, can definitely increase the risk of bleeding and can definitely increase the risk of hypoglycemia, which of course is of concern to your patients who have type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, especially since no one likes to have food between their teeth when they visit the dentist or hygienist. And so maybe they don't eat, right? Maybe they do take their medication and now they're, you know, they're at risk for hypoglycemia because the fact is sitting in a dental chair is stressful and you can easily use up all your glycogen stored in your muscles and now the tank runs dry and hypoglycemia is the course to be served next.
I find it amazing as a dentist when I review a medical history with a patient, usually new patients or whatever, they will say they're not on any medications. And I was like, oh, wow, that's great. What about supplements? Well, usually somebody's taking something. So asking the question is so vital for your practice.
Yeah, it's the three questions, right? Well, you and I have always talked about this, Pam. It's, you know, what do you take? Right? Don't say drug. Don't say medication. Just say, what do you take? And leave the dead air. I know it's awkward. I know it's uncomfortable. I know it's weird. But just say, what do you take? And stop talking. Leave the dead air and give them that room, that space to start talking. Right? And then why do you take it? Because there are medications people take for multiple reasons and you need to know, right? Because it affects treatment planning. And then did you take it today? And those are the questions that we always ask to give us the most information we can about a patient when we're taking the medical history so we can better treatment plan for them.
Final question. So sure. I can't say that I've seen a patient that's super bloody and I attribute it to ginger. Like off the top of my head, I can't think of it. But say, for example, a new patient comes in, they do take ginger, they're getting their periodontal evaluation, and it seems like they're bleeding significantly. How long, like say that you're going to treatment plan scaling and root planing or something like that. When should you ask them to stop taking ginger in preparation for a future appointment?
Okay, so it's all over the place, right? I've seen, you know, for example, I've seen medical doctors especially say, you know, discontinue ginger 2 weeks before elective surgery, okay? So on the dental side of things, you know, I don't know what a good time frame is because, again, studies are lacking. But keep in mind, it's not just ginger as well. It's the five G's that we always identify, right? It's ginger, garlic, ginseng, ginkgo, and golden seal. And some patients may be taking more than one of those five and therefore also increasing their risk of bleeding. So it may be advisable to tell patients to stop taking all dietary supplements if they can, with, you know, again, with their doctor's awareness, medical doctor's awareness, because quite frankly, you know, we don't know how long is long enough.
So interesting. Wow. All right. Well, you heard it here. Five G's, ginger's one of them, and it's going to cause bleeding. So thank you for enlightening us on this topic.
Well, thank you, Pam. I'm looking forward to next time. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Appreciate it very much.